morning, Hope Church family. It is so good to see you. My name is Jenny Miles, and I want to welcome you to church this morning at the lake. The reality is we know it's a holiday weekend, and so many of you are probably on vacation. And if you're not, if you're at home, well, guess what? For the next hour, you're here at the lake with us. So our entire service today is taking place here at the lake. It's going to be a special treat. We're so excited to be here with you guys. If it's your very first time being a part of our Hope Church services, then I would encourage you to jump over to our chat. There's a link in the chat where you can get connected, or you can go to our website. We have a link there as well for you to get connected in a different way. And so we would encourage you to do that. We want to get to know you. We want to meet you and give us a chance to reach out and say hello and thank you for being with us. So we're fixing to get started. We're going to have our worship. Pastor Tad has a wonderful message prepared. But before we jump in, I would ask that you jump over to the chat and just say good morning. Let us know where you're coming from. And just, hey, happy 4th. Thank you, guys. We'll get started here in a second.
What's up, Hope Church family? Happy 4th of July weekend. I hope that you got some time off this weekend to just invest in yourself and the people that matter to you the most. We intentionally took this holiday weekend off, mainly, let's be honest, because most of you probably weren't coming to church anyway, and that's okay. But we wanted to have a time to put this teaching series into practice, a chance to refresh our souls, to let God speak into our lives, and again, to make some intentional time for the people that matter the most in our lives. And that really is our desire and our goal for today and really for this teaching series. Before going any further, though, I do want to just acknowledge really fast, you may not be aware of this, but behind all these cameras are about 12 people who took vacation time today to make this experience happen for all of us. And so I don't know how many of you be willing to take a whole day off to make this happen. But can we just show them right now in the chat some huge appreciation for all of the work they put in to make this service happen for all of us today? We really do appreciate it. I hope you do as well, because they do such a phenomenal job. Before I hop into today's message, let me just tell you about a couple quick things we have going on around Hope Church. And I'm going to put this up front today because I have a feeling some of you might sign off a little early. And so I want to make sure that you're aware of this. But next weekend is July 10th. So I don't know when you're hearing this message or when you're watching this, but next Sunday is July 10th. And we're going to enter into our 5-week summer schedule. And so again, just walking a line with this teaching series, we want to be very respectful of all of our volunteers who do so much to make the weekends happen at Hope Church across the board. And we know that it's a high vacation time, and we do want to encourage people to get a break and get some rest. And so for 5 weeks, from Sunday, July 10th through Sunday, August the 7th, we are going to move to our summer schedule of 1:10 a.m. service only. And so that will affect obviously in person, but also online. And so one service only at 10 a.m. And then beginning August the 14th, we will return to our regularly scheduled program, but our service times will move to 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. So we'll get you all that information, but I want to get in front of you 5 weeks, 10 a.m. service only. I want you to know as well, next weekend is a Hope Kids Takeover weekend. And so the amazing Kay Thomas and her amazing team, fantastic team of ninjas that we call the Hope Kids team, are going to show up next week with an amazing service for you and your family. So I want to encourage you to make sure you're there next weekend, Hope Kids Takeover weekend, 10 a.m. only. As well as if you are in person next week, you're going to get a free ticket to the Sock Puppets ball game. In fact, next Sunday night, again, July 7th at 6 o'clock p.m., we are all going to converge at the Sock Puppets ballpark, and we're going to have Hope Church Night at the Park. And so I want to invite you to be there, get your free ticket next week. I even heard a little rumor that Sock Squash, which is the Sock Puppets mascot, is actually going to be at Hope Church next week. That's a rumor, I think, but nonetheless, you have to come and find out. So it's going to be a great day, and so I hope you'll join us. So today what I want to do is I just want to spend some time today continuing our teaching series, but I really want to wrap up this teaching series. I believe this teaching series has been incredibly impactful for so many of us. I know even personally in my own life, as I've taught through some of these weeks and listened to some of our staff teach through the other weeks, it has been so incredibly impactful in my life. This teaching series was specifically designed to get us to stop long enough and to process the cost that so many things have on our lives. And not just the cost it has on our own personal lives, but if not dealt with, if we're not healed from some of these things, if we don't know learn how to really manage some of these things properly, then we end up passing that cost on to others. And that's kind of what we've talked about. So throughout this teaching series, we talked about relational baggage, the amount of relational baggage that you and I accumulate over the years, and how we have to begin to deal with that. We talked about our approach to time and how we should manage our time. We've talked about our approach to fun and just learning how to have fun, learning about Jesus in our life. We talked about our approach to values and why they matter and how we view and spend money. And ultimately, even last week, how we find rest and how we find how we get refueled in our life. Because the reality is, if we don't learn these things well, and again, we don't heal and learn from some of these things, then again, we'll just pass that off to other people. So our prayer has been that you and I would learn our Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15 through 16 principle. And what we learn from that passage is that you and I, as followers of Jesus, are called to live our lives much differently than the rest of the world. And so we're told to redeem our time, which means that we're to purchase, to ransom, to take hold of the time that God has given us, because we're told in Scripture that the days are evil, right? They are just every day, they're relentless. Every day, just time ticks away, the calendar ticks. And so we don't want to just log days for no reason. We want to be intentional. And in that passage, it says, so why? So we can live out God's will and purpose. And so I would tell you throughout the series, what I would tell you is that one, we got to redeem our time, make it count, but we got to redeem our relationships, our marriages, our parenting relationships, our friendships. We got to redeem our money. We got to make it count. We got to be smart with it. We got to redeem our values. We got to redeem all these things because, again, they're evil. And we show up one day and we go through the days and we go through the hours and we just miss out on the intentional focus that God has in using those moments and those things God has given us for His will and His purpose. Now, all of this is to hopefully get us to a very healthy and sustainable pace of our life. 2 weeks ago, we looked at an equation for life. We said that a change of pace and a change of place is what gives us a change of perspective. And so today, maybe for you, it's some time off. And so hopefully it's a change of pace. We're out here by the lake today. Hopefully it's a change of place, or maybe you're by a pool or a lake or an ocean, or I don't know where you are today. But hopefully what it will do is give you a change of perspective so you can begin to see God differently in this life that God has called you to live. So what I want to do today is I'll wrap up this teaching series. I want to just hit on one final thing, and it's something that I kind of jumped into in week two of this teaching series as I talked about time. But I really want to dig into something a little more with our time today. And I want to talk about just the life of hurry that so many of us live. And so my challenge for us today is that you and I would begin to eliminate the hurry from our lives. Because if we don't, understand this, hurry has a high cost. And many of us know this. The more hurried we are in life, it has a huge cost. And again, we pass that cost on to so many people. I don't know about you. Again, I talked about a little of this in week two. My life feels like I'm constantly in a hurry. And again, we shared the song from Alabama, I'm in a hurry, and I don't know why. I really don't know why. I mean, just take today, right? Just to get out here. I was in such a hurry this morning. I was blitzing through everything, got in the car. We're driving out here to Lake Hyco. I'm sure I was speeding. I'm going 100 miles an hour, just running around, getting a million things done, because in my head, I want everything to be perfect. I want all of it to happen the way that I think that it should. And if I can be honest with you, it's because I'm in love with this illusion of control, right? And many of you feel the same way, right? We love the illusion of control. And so we're constantly in a hurry because we have so many things going on. And in order for us to get it to that perfect state or to get it done, we create this illusion that the more rushed I am and the more time that I try to squeeze out of every moment, that I can make these things happen. And so we all chase this, right? And so we love that illusion of keeping all the balls juggling, making it all happening, but it never quite happens, does it? And it always comes at some cost and an expense. As we hurry through people, usually there's a wake of mess left behind. I've been very open and transparent just in the last year or two about just me living my life at an extreme hurried pace so often in life. Been very open and honest about an extreme burnout that I went through really beginning in 2020, that was really long before 2020. It was just a sum total of my life that kind of bled into 2020, going into the pandemic, going into some staff changes, going into a really intense political season. And I just kind of hit a wall. And so at the expense of being incredibly vulnerable today, which I'm going to be, I want to read to you something that I wrote 2 years ago in my own personal journal. And I'll be honest with you. It's very raw. It's very real. And I want to share this because I think there's so many of you that can probably relate to some of the words that I wrote down in my own life. And so here's what I wrote. It's a little long, but I'll keep all of us engaged, hopefully. So just stay with me. I wrote this. I said, God, I'm so tired. I'm so exhausted. And I'm so sick of feeling this way. Sometimes I rush. Okay, I always rush. I rush and I don't even have a reason to be in a hurry. Hurry is just become a part of my life. I rush so much that I don't even feel like I'm living life. I'm not sure if I ever really feel fully alive. Maybe some moments here and there, but my mind never stops moving to the next thing. No time to be in this moment because something else is always pressing. Someone else always needs me. Dear God, I am so tired of being needed. I often feel like I'm on a roller coaster, just holding on, trying not to fall off and hoping I can keep it all up and keep it all on track. I do a great job of fooling people. They all think I have it all together, but I don't. I don't think anyone has any idea how often I feel so overwhelmed and anxious. God, my kids are getting older, and I find myself fully present but emotionally disconnected. I find myself so irritable and short with them, and I don't know why. God, why do I find myself yelling all the time? There are so many great things happening in our church and ministry and so many things to be thankful for in my life, but I don't feel like celebrating any of it. I have everything that should equate joy, but joy doesn't define my life. Happiness seems like a destination I never quite arrive at. Some days, not all days, but some days I start to lose hope because I know this isn't the life that God intended for me to live. But I still convince myself that success is doing more. Success is being more. In order to do more and be more, I rush more. I hurry more. But if I'm honest, more and more is just making less and less of the real me. So I find myself fantasizing about walking away from it all. No, I'm not talking about ending my life or walking away from Becky and the kids, but just walking away from all of my responsibility. I find myself fantasizing about selling everything we own and moving into our camper beside a river somewhere, enjoying long walks and long conversations and long days, living life off the grid with no financial pressure, no burdens, and no stresses of the world influencing my life or the life of my family. I don't want my kids to follow my footsteps, but the more I live like this, the more likely they will too. Life is so much more than this. God, I know this, but I can't wrap my head or my hands around grabbing a hold of it. A simple life, a slower life, a fulfilled life, that just seems ridiculous. Who could live that life? That doesn't seem realistic. And I really don't think it would solve any of my problems anyway. So I guess I'll just suck it up and convince myself this is normal. I'll give myself another TED talk and tell myself it won't always be this way. But yet I keep finding myself in the same place. Maybe it will always be this way. God, I hope it will not always be this way. And here's where I close. I said, God, I need you to show me a different way, a better way. I want my life to count, but most importantly, I want it to count to the people who matter the most. I confess I've allowed myself to arrive at this place. I know this isn't the life you have for me, so show me another way. Show me a better way. Break me of all of this. God, I need you to eliminate the hurry in my life. Well, I guess I just need you to help me eliminate the hurry that I've caused of my life, because I know this isn't the life you have for me. Please, God, don't let this be the life that you have for me. I don't know if that sounds like any of you today. I don't know if you can relate to any of that, but I often have found myself over the last 2 years revisiting some of these thoughts that I was struggling with at a very difficult time and season of life. I know this may come as a shock to you, but I don't always practice what I preach, right? I preach about rest and refueling, and yet I struggle to find the time to do it myself. I preach about being fully present, but I often struggle with being fully present. I've told you guys several times that last year when I was going through this season, I picked up a copy of a book by a guy named John Mark Comer called The Ruthless Elimination of Hurry, which I would strongly suggest you snag a copy of. I don't get any royalties for that, but John Mark, if you would love to give me some royalties for that, I'd appreciate that as well. But in his book, he really talks about how to begin to eliminate hurry from your life. And at one point, he talks about a conversation between two authors, John Ortberg and Dallas Willard. And he says one day that John Ortberg called up Dallas Willard and he said, "What do I need to do to become the me that I want to be, the me that I know that I need to be?" And he said there was a long silence on the other end of the line. And he said Dallas Willard spoke up and he said, "You must ruthlessly eliminate all hurry from your life." And so John said he scribbled that down as fast as he could in his journal. And he said, "Okay, what else do I need to do? What else do I need to do?" He said after another long silence, Dallas Willard said, "There is nothing else." Listen to these words. He said, "Hurry is the greatest enemy of spiritual life in our day. You must ruthlessly eliminate hurry from your life." Let's be honest. Hurry has such an impact on our life. John Mark would go on to talk about a condition that we all suffer from called hurried sickness. He says that hurry is a form of violence on our soul. And I'm going to give you, he gives us 10 quick symptoms that I think all of us will be able to relate to one, if not all of these. And these are 10 symptoms of hurried sickness. The first one is irritability. He says you find yourself getting mad or frustrated or just annoyed way too easy. Normal things begin to irk you. He says, just look at how you treat people that are the closest to you. He says, hypersensitivity. All it takes is a minor comment, a grumpy email, a little turn of events to set you off. You just can't seem to roll with the punches, right? He says, number three, restlessness. When you actually do try to slow down and rest, you can't relax. You multitask by watching TV or going on vacation. You go to bed early, but you toss and turn. Your mind and body are hyped up on the drug of speed. Number four, workaholism. Or maybe for you, it's just nonstop activity. You just don't know when or how to stop. Or worse, you just can't stop. At the end of the day, you have sunset fatigue, but you have nothing left to give to your spouse, your children, or loved ones. Number five, emotional numbness. You don't have the capacity to feel another's pain, or even your own pain for that matter. Number six, out of order priorities. You feel disconnected from your identity. You feel disconnected from your calling. You get sucked into the urgent and not the important. You still haven't gotten around to all the things you said were the most important in your life. Number 7, you lack care for your body. You don't have time for the basics, for 8 hours of sleep, for daily exercise, to ever have a home-cooked meal. Number 8, escapist behaviors. When we're too tired, we turn to distraction of choice, whether that's overeating, overdrinking, binge-watching Netflix, browsing social media, looking at porn, and getting stuck into all sorts of socially acceptable addictions. Number 9, slippage of spiritual disciplines. When you get over busy, the first thing that truly gives life are the first things you let go of rather than the first things that we run to. And then number 10, you feel isolation, which you feel disconnected from God, from others, and even from your own soul. You're so stressed and distracted that you can't settle down long enough to enjoy God's company in prayer, in quiet time, or even with your friends. So what's the problem? The problem is hurry, right? We all know this. So what's the solution? Well, the secret to curing all this is something we all know, but we all struggle to put into practice. We all struggle to ever really accept this. The secret is found in Scripture. It's actually found in 8 simple words. And these 8 words that we find so foreign to us and yet so difficult to grasp, but yet so freeing for us. In John chapter 3, verse 30, it says this: He, as in God, must become greater, and I must become less. In other words, He, my relationship with Him, who He is, must become more so that I can become less. The secret isn't more. We know this, right? But the secret truly is less, and less is completely contrary to anything that we are told in this world. We are convinced that more will solve all of our issues, that the next thing will do it. The next house, the next raise, the next job, the next marriage, the next vacation, more, 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 more. But more doesn't solve anything because our souls still ache. Our lives are still incomplete. Our hearts still long for more. Less, honestly, isn't the pursuit of any of us, if we could just be honest today. No one says, I want less responsibility. Maybe you do when you're frustrated. No one says, I want less money. No one says, I want less influence. And yet in our pursuit of more, our life is becoming less and less because we only have so much we can give and we only have so much we can bear. And the more we overcommit and the more we overspend and the more we overbear the burdens of life, the less and less we have for ourselves, our families, and our relationship with God. Ultimately, the more that we're chasing after causes us to become so much less. Now, listen to me. There isn't some magical equation today that you can apply to your life in order just to tweak a few things or to change up your focus here or there so that you can experience some change, but not too much change. Let's get serious. All of us want some change in our life because we all recognize hurried sickness. But how much of us are willing to change our pursuit of more? I'm talking about today an extremely different way of approaching life. It's a complete rewiring of our systems and our hard drives. To experience more of life, listen to me, I have to relinquish more of it to Him. And the more I give to Him, listen to me, the less I control. But the less I'm in control of means the less that I carry, the less burdens on my shoulders, the less weight that I feel, the less stress and anxiety in my life, the less fear, the less I acquire, the less I have to hold on to, the less bitterness and resentment that I cling to in my life, the less I overspend, the less I overcommit, the less I try to strain and build my thing. I become less and He becomes more. And as a result, life becomes more full and whole. And somehow, some way, this life just seems foreign to us. But doesn't it seem incredibly inviting? The more that He becomes to us, the less this world impacts us. The more that He becomes my source, the less I depend on anything in this world to be my source. See, throughout this series, we've watched the model of Jesus. We've seen the more and more that His life became in high demand, the more and more He withdrew from the busyness to quiet places to be with His Father. Why? Because Jesus understood that the more of this world would never satisfy His soul. So He withdrew intentionally. He intentionally chose to become less. I mean, we see this throughout Scripture. He became less. He chose in humility to become less. And if Jesus was committed to less, then you and I, as followers of Jesus, we have to be committed to less as well. So in my life, I am slowly grinding through, slowly learning that true joy is found in less. That true rest is found in less. That true hope is found in less. That true life is found in less. That true contentment is found in less. And that true simplicity is ultimately freeing. The statement says that less is more, but really it is truth. Less truly is more. There is so much freedom found in that. John Mark Comer closes his book out by saying, how do we slow down? How do we simplify? How do we live intentionally in the middle of the chaos of the noisy, fast-paced, hurried digital world that we all call home? He says, well, the answer is easy. We follow Jesus. You know, the Christian life is an open invitation for you and I to walk with Jesus. It never invites us to run with Jesus. Can you imagine for a moment if Jesus said, hey, come on, let's go, let's run, try to keep up. Oh, the moment you fall behind and you begin to run out of breath because you can't keep up at a speed, imagine if he threw things at you and made fun of you and beat you while you were down, but he invites you to walk in him and to find rest in him. I'm trying to learn how to walk because I know this is like a mind bender, but like walking is way less than running, right? And he hasn't expected us to do this at warp speed. He wants us to slow down at a speed that will bring us the rest and nourishment and wholeness that we need. So let me just close with this. I want to close with a passage today that so many of us are familiar with. It's in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 through 30. But I want to read it to you from the Message version because I want you to hear it as if Jesus was saying these exact words to you today, because I believe he is. Listen to what he says. He says, are you tired? Are you tired? Are you worn out? How many of you are burnt out? He says, if that's you, if you have hurried sickness, look what he says. He says, come to me. Listen to this invitation. He says, get away with me. Get away from what? Get away from the madness of this world and the craziness of life. And he says what? And you'll recover your life. He says, I'll show you how to take a real rest. Look at this word. He says, walk with me and work with me. You don't know how to do it? What he says? He says, watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. That's the invitation today. That's the invitation. The cost of a hurried life is too great. So I want to invite you to join me in a pursuit of eliminating all hurry from our lives. I know we're not going to get it right. We're not always going to get it right. We're going to fail. But let's journey together and walk with Jesus. And I believe that you and I can begin to discover the life that Jesus intends for us to live. And so I want to encourage you in this series, let God pour into your soul, your spirit, your heart. Continue beyond this day of finding ways to ruthlessly eliminate the hurry of your life and begin to walk in the goodness of Jesus. Let me pray for you today. God, today I pray as fellow strugglers, God, in this thing called life, that we would choose, God, to eliminate the hurry of our life. The cost is too great. It's too great on our souls. And we're not living at the pace of life that you designed for us. God, may we reevaluate our pursuit of more, our pursuit of hurriedness and busyness, God, because it's costing us too much. God, may we see for who you are today. May we be people today, as it says in those words in John, who choose to become less so that you can become more in our life. God, it really is truth. God, when you become everything, all of a sudden, all the other things don't become so important in our life. And today we surrender and submit to the fact that we chase so many things other than you. God, the reality is that once you become enough, God, you are more than enough. And so, God, I pray that we would see you today as more than enough for our lives. God, we love you. God, refresh our souls, nourish our spirits, God. Let us be all that you've called for us to be. God, let us be intentional with this time. God, as we look ahead to what you have on the horizon, God, school's going to start back in just a few weeks and summer's going to be over, God. And if we don't change some habits and routines, we'll find ourselves right back into the same hectic, chaotic pace in the fall. God, we love you. Thank you for your patience with us. Thank you as you walk this life with us. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Heart of hope.